Again to the Greater Hines Street Missionary Baptist Church Wednesday evening Bible study, and it's a delight again to have you sharing with us and joining us, those wonderful and faithful members, as well as those who are watching us across the country. We just greet you in the name of Jesus our Christ. Tonight we will we're in 1 Timothy. We left off in chapter 1. And so we'll be going into chapter 2 tonight, dealing with Paul's duties and order for the local church. So let us go into to the word of prayer, and then we'll get started. God, our Father, we thank you so much for this time of sharing. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the writing of this inspired apostle as he's given orders to the church, as well as to his young son in the ministry, Timothy. And as we study your word, oh God, may we not only be learners and hearers, but we'll be doers of the word, that we'll be instructed in righteousness and how we should conduct ourselves in our churches and the respective duties of those who are part of the body of Christ. We just thank you so much for this time of sharing. Anoint us afresh, precious Holy Spirit, as you lead in this study. Anoint my mind. These lips of clay, the things that you will have me to say. In the name of him who is our Christ, we pray. And all of us said together, amen, amen. All right, first of all, we are in 1 Timothy, the second chapter. And verse 2 and 3, let me tell you at the outset, chapters 2 and 3, Paul discusses the public ministry of the church and the role that different members, respective members, should play in the church. And chapter 1 dealt with the ministry of the word, And in chapter 2 emphasizes prayer. It's an emphasis on prayer in chapter 2, as we will embark upon chapter 2 tonight. So really, call your friends, your neighbors, share those who you're in fellowship with. Tell them that the Wednesday evening Bible study is on the app, the Greater Hines Street Missionary Baptist Church. And we just thank you so much for taking the time out to share, to grow, to be blessed, and to be enlarged. Amen. Now, the two main ministries of the pastor in the church, the two main ministries are the Word of God and prayer. Those are his two main ministries of the church. And they are the Word of God, to preach, to teach the Word of God, and prayer. And so it is important that the church, however, have a balance. The church must have a balanced ministry of the Word of God and prayer. It must be balanced. Because the Word instructs the church. And prayer inspires the church to obey the Word of God. So the church has an abundance of the church that has an abundance of Bible teaching, but little prayer. It's out of balance. And so what it will have then, it will have light, but no heat. It will have light, but no heat. And so it will be an oxidized church. It will be a frozen church. And so the other extreme, however, is a church that has much prayer and religious enthusiasm, but little teaching from the word. And what this will produce, an out of balance situation, and it will produce a group of people with the zeal. They will have the zeal, but no knowledge. Have the zeal, but no knowledge. Enthusiasm, but no knowledge. So then when we look at the place of prayer in the local church, as in the home, but we're just talking about the church, that's the entity that we are dealing with tonight. It is important. Paul is emphasizing, first of all, and let me read. I want us to go through verse 1 through 8, and I'm going to just read them, and then we will go through with our critical analysis and exegesis of it as we go forward. But let me read the first 8 verses, for there may be those who have some vision impairment, and for me to just to go and expound, and we have not read it, would be a disservice to you. I'm going to read, verse 1 says, and we're in 1 Timothy, the second chapter. Verse 1 reads, I exhort therefore that first of all, listen, this is it. First of all, supplication, prayer, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men. That's what he is saying here. First of all, in other words, this is the priority. First of all, this is the supreme importance. It is a person, every person needs prayer. This is of supreme importance. And that is, it is by supplication, by intercession, by thanksgiving. Those three entities there. Let me go on and read as I promise. Verse 2. For kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. Verse 3. For this is good and acceptable in the light of God, our Savior. Verse 4. Who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Verse 5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Verse 6. Who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Verse 7. Whereunto I am ordained a preacher and an apostle, I speak the truth in Christ and lie not, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity. Verse 8, and this is where we'll stop. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. So this is what he's saying. Paul is saying that the local church that does not pray because it is expected to do things, it prays because prayer is vital to the life of the local church. Prayer is vital. The Holy Spirit works in the church through prayer and the word of God. That's why it's essential that we teach, that we pray, and that we teach. So the church that prays will have power. That church that prays will have power and will make a lasting impact for Christ. It will edify the body of Christ. It will have a lasting impact. It will have eternal value. Note how the believer in Acts turned the prayer and overcame their enemy. This is what they did in Acts. We've talked about this. So Paul exhorts us to pray because it's so important. And then and we will know four things that is mentioned here, that there is supplication. Well, supplication. What is supplication? It means telling God our need. It means specific needs. Telling him our specific need. We are specific in prayer. That's what supplication is in a nutshell. And then not only that, that's number one, what he's saying. It's nature of prayer. And number two, prayer meaning worship and adoration. We worship him. We have him in adoration. That's what it means, in adoration for God. And all men need prayer, the high and the low, the educated and the uneducated, the important and the unimportant. They all need prayer. They may appear that they don't. They may appear to be super saints and super spiritual, but the rich and the poor, the leaders and the followers, we all need prayer. The old and the young, the friend and the enemy, we all need prayer. That's how we get access, how we have this interaction, this relationship to God. And then it encourages us to, not only it's an encouragement, but it's a charge. It's a charge that we have to keep. And so just think of what the difference that it can make. If we were all in an attitude of prayer, just think how many more loved ones that we can be saved and helped. They're the most difficult one to witness to. But we have to keep praying, keep praying. How many more within our communities, in our state, in our nation, and indeed the world that could be blessed if the church would seriously go down in prayer? How few problems we would have existing in the community if the church was more serious about prayer. And so when we look at verse 2, well, let me talk about the prayer that refers to the special times of prayer that we have to set aside in devotion. You have to fight for that time in prayer to be alone with God. You have to fight for it. Otherwise, that busy schedule will interfere. Your itinerary will push that devotional time that you have out of your schedule. So we have to be careful. Intercession. We all are intercessors. We make intercessions. When we make intercession, this refers to holding. And praying and standing before God on behalf of someone else, on another. We make intercessions every day. Particularly times of in our worship service, we all are intercessors. We all are intercessors. We're standing in prayer for someone else. We're going before God. Keep in mind that Jesus Christ is indeed the mediator, but we go before him on behalf of others. That's what an intercessor is, simply means in their lives. And we boldly go before them, expecting God to hear and answer prayer on behalf of someone else. And then not only that, but thanksgiving. We should have thanksgiving. He said we should have thanksgiving when we go before him. We should thank him for hearing us and for answering our prayers. And for things, even though what we are praying for may not have been manifested, but we pray for thanking him for it, even though it has not been manifested, because we're calling those things that be not as though they were. That's faith in the prayer that we pray. But Matthew 5:44 says, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good for them that hate you, and pray for them which is despitefully misusing you and persecute you." So we have the obligation to pray for everyone. Verse 2. We would pray for those in authority. They call them kings here. Those who are in authority, who in over civil government. We should pray for them. No matter how good or how bad they are, we should pray for them. Sometimes maybe we get the government that we have because we don't pray properly for them. Even those that's not in your party, Republican, Democrat, Independent, or Cosmocrat, We should, no matter how moral or immoral they are, we should pray for them. Because Paul is writing this letter, and keeping in mind, Nero is emperor of Rome at the time. And he's the one who had Paul beheaded. But Paul here is saying we have to pray for them, no matter how just or unjust they are. We have an obligation as Christian to pray for them. So the Christian attitude toward the state is of utmost importance. Whether the civil authority or we have to obey, but if they, where the conflict comes in, where we don't obey civil authority, is if it causes us to disobey God, then that's where you draw the line. We will not obey a law that caused us to disobey the law of God. No, we don't cross that line. No way. And so that's why we pray for the kings. That's just civil authority, even the heathen government, because they provide order in society. There must be structure in society. If we did not have order in our government and our political subdivisions, then there will be anarchy, and people will be have laws of their own making. So therefore, we pray to God that it would give them wisdom and knowledge, give them morality and justice, that they would give them courage and boldness to stand for the least, to stand for the lost, and with compassion and understanding. And so, when we look at now, let's transition to verse 3 through 7. We've already read it responsively now. And so he says here, when we're looking at the mediator, prayer, salvation, ransom, redemption, these are the words that we'll be looking at. First of all, God is our Savior, and he wills that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. And this is that. These are their five reasons that I'm giving you here now. That's the first one. Five reasons given why we are to pray for the salvation of all men, and includes the rulers. I've given you one. That is, God is our Savior, and he wills, it's his will, that all men will be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. Although all men will not be saved, because some will reject. And James says in 14 and 6, he says, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man come to the Father but by me. So this is the reason we should pray for all men, both the rulers and the citizens, the high and low, educated and uneducated, the moral and the immoral, the just and the unjust, the civilized and the uncivilized, the saved and the lost. So God wants all men to be saved regardless of who they are and no matter how evil they have been. So you can't go too low that you can't be saved. What an awesome God we serve. What grace that we have. Okay, and second, there is only one God, not many gods, but one God. There's one God. And the point is this: since there is only one God, there can be only one way to reach him. So that makes sense. Only one way to reach him. Only one way to be saved. Well, this is the discussion that we are to have. There is none other God but one. Praise his holy name. And the next number three, there is only one mediator between God and man. In other words, the mediator is the one who goes in between. He is, if one is to be saved, then he is to approach God in a way that is acceptable to God. A way that's acceptable to God. Because there is only one perfect person, God himself. And so no man can stand before God, not in his own name of righteousness. So because man is an imperfect being, he's called to a perfect mission. And the only one can get us through is Jesus Christ, our Lord. So God takes man's belief and count it as righteousness of Christ. So God takes your belief, your faith in Jesus Christ, and then he counted as righteousness of Jesus Christ. And so I stand behind him. So God won't see me. He sees Jesus Christ. Glory to God. And God accepts man's faith and honor his son as righteousness. So he takes my faith, your faith. God lets the righteous of his son, Jesus Christ, cover man's sin. And he took it and nailed it on the cross. So God accepts man's faith as righteousness of Jesus Christ. So that's what it does. Number four, the man Christ Jesus gave himself a ransom for all. The word ransom means an exchange something for something else. That ransom is it's an exchange. You've heard of people being kidnapped, and if you want to get the, you know, your loved one back or whatever it is back, then you got to pay this ransom of $1 million. That's the ransom. And so this is something in exchange for something. And so that's what Christ has done for us. The word ransom, that it means an exchange for something. And so the man Christ Jesus exchanged his life for the life of man. He gave himself for us. And so he had exchanged it. He exchanged it. Praise his name. And so God counts the death of Christ for man. And so that's how we say he died for us. Fifth one. Ministers are ordained, are appointed to proclaim the salvation of God. Paul said three things about himself. God had appointed me to be a preacher. He said, God appointed me. I didn't have to go before no council. I didn't have to go before some catechizers. I was appointed by God himself to be a preacher, an ambassador who was appointed to go forth to proclaim his message as an ambassador in our country, to go to another country who represents the country that sent him, the government that sent him. And so Jesus is the mediator between God and man, and he has given himself a ransom for all. And so God has appointed Paul to be an apostle. An apostle, a person who had been sent as a very special witness and on a very special mission. So the minister is sent forth on a special mission to bear witness that Jesus Christ is the mediator between God and man. Jesus Christ has paid the ransom for our sin. So then he says he had appointed him as an apostle. The question becomes is whether or not the age of the apostle over. We're not going to get into that. That's another teaching. So, but God has appointed him as a teacher, a person who instructs people into the faith and truth of God's word. The truth of God's word. It is the gift to root and ground people in doctrine, reproof, correction, and righteousness. It grounds you. It roots you. It gives you a foundation. So the point is this, God has called ministers to proclaim the faith and the truth of the mediator and the great ransom price that he paid for man's salvation. Oh my God. Therefore, we must pray for all men that all will receive the message and the minister to be saved. And so verse 8, in this section, is with prayer. Pray everywhere. Pray in the right spirit. You can't pray with wrath, because the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. You can't pray with all kinds of malice and hatred in your heart, ill will toward your neighbor or your sister or your brother or your anyone. Because it's not going anywhere. You're just saying something that maybe pacify yourself. And I doubt if it pacifies yourself, because there is internal disorganization, internal disorder, internal frustration. And you can't pray with that kind of of headwear on you. A person should never stop praying. He should be praying all day long as he walks through the day in an attitude of prayer, what he's saying. He should develop unbroken communion and fellowship with the Lord. And you can't commune and fellowship with the Lord with a nasty spirit, with a nasty attitude, and with ill will toward anyone. He will not hear your prayer. You can recite it all day and all night, but he will not hear your prayer. He will not go against his word. And we should, as we pray for others in our home, school, church, community in the country, he should pray for, you know, those in America, Central America, Africa, Asia. Pray for all men. And so the believer is to pray and keep on praying. He is not to stop praying, no matter what, where it is. But the believer is also told how to pray. Told how to pray. Number one, he is to pray lifting up holy hands. This is an attitude, lifting up holy hands. Now, you can have lift up holy hands, but if your heart is downcast and is nasty and then is unrepentant, you can hold up holy hands all day long and all night long. But if your heart is not right, you may as well keep your hands down, because it's an attitude of the heart. You have to go into a situation that, in legal terminology, if you're going to do equity, if you're going in court to seek some equity, some relief, you have to go in with clean hands. Clean hands mean you can't have any type of ill will, some hidden and nasty agenda. The clean hand, that means clean heart, is a posture, it's a metaphor for a clean heart, a clean mind, clean attitude, and the right spirit when we go before God. So that as when we come before him, we must, and as we think that's forbidden, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. He will not hear you. Psalm 66 and 18, if you want a reference. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear you. He will not hear you. He will not hear you. If there's iniquity, there's something in your heart. Isaiah 59 and 2 says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear you. He will not hear you. Isaiah 64 and 7 says, and there is none that calleth upon thy name that stirreth up himself to take hold of thee. For thou hast hid thy face from me and hast consumed us because of our iniquities. It's in the word of God. So how else do we pray? He is to pray without anger. You have to pray without anger or feeling in his heart and against someone else. Very simply, what I'm saying to you tonight, my sisters and brothers who are watching us tonight, God does not accept us unless we accept others. God will not accept us until we accept others. God does not forgive us unless we forgive others. He won't forgive us. That's against his nature. And we said, when we pray, our Father, forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. And therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there remember that thy brother had aught against thee, leave that thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come forth, and then you can bring your gift. Then you can bring your gift. And then also, if you're praying now, another posture, praying, he is to pray without doubting. Pray without doubting. There's no need to pray if we do not think God is going to hear us. It's an exercise in futility. It's useless. If we ask him doubting, we are not trusting him. And it's a walk of faith. We're not trusting him. We're not trusting his presence. We're not trusting his power to meet our needs. We are certainly denying God's care. That's what we're doing. We're denying his care and we're denying his power. And we're destroying the name of God among men. Therefore, we must believe God when we pray. We must believe that he is, and he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. It's a walk of faith. But in Matthew 21 and 23 says, and when he was come into the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came unto him as he was teaching and said, by what authority dost thou do these things, and who give thee this authority? But look what Mark 11, 24 says. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire when you pray, believe that you receive it them, and then you shall have them. You have to believe it before you can receive it. You have to see it. You have to see it first. And then you can, he will move in your life. He will move, I guarantee you. But it's a walk of faith. You have to believe it. You have to believe it. And then when you believe it, oh, he will move in your life. And he will do wonders for your life. That's all we have to do. It's a walk by faith. And it's when we look at also this verse, I'm trying to keep from going forward in verse 9 to start here because my time is just about out. But I really wanted to go into the women of the church, which is somewhat controversial in our today's mindset in the culture of this time. And so it's going to really be, you know, be quite involved. I was hoping I could have gotten there tonight, but it appears that that won't happen. But when we look at, again, when we just go to look at verse 8, it lays down, again, three conditions for praying in the local church. Three conditions in praying for the local church. Number one, without wrath, without ill will, without anger, without hostility in your heart. Pray that it be removed. So that's one of the conditions, without wrath. And you must do it loving one another. We are commanded to love. With love, that's the new commandment that I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. As I have loved you. And by this, men will know that ye are my disciples because you love one another. You can see it. It can witness when you walk up. If you have that nasty attitude, when you walk up, people will know it. Because it shows on your face. It shows on your face. It shows in your walk. It shows how you carry yourself. It just has an aura of negativity about you, and people will know it. People will know it. So the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. So that's one of the conditions. And then again, do it with holy hands. When you pray with holy hands, that is clean, obedient lives. Clean and obedient lives when you pray. Please, when you pray, let clean, let your hands be clean, let your life be clean. Let your lives be clean. And men can see it when you show up in the room. They can feel your presence. Whether or not it's one that's from the pit of hell, no matter how holy you walk or how holy you talk, they will know it. Thirdly, faith. You have to have that faith as we leave tonight, because the men are to take the lead in the prayer ministry. That's what he's saying in the local church, and we'll deal with that more profoundly and deep. And Paul has his foundation for that. He says men should take the lead in the local church, and he goes back to Genesis for the very foundation, and he established with the doctrine how men should take the lead, and that we shouldn't pervert the order of God, because the order of God has been perverted, and you see so much turmoil and mess in the church because the order has been breached. And when the order is breached, then the outcome will be perverted. And so we'll deal further with that as we go forward in our next lesson next Wednesday, if it's the Lord's will. We will be dealing as deeply as we can with the women in the local church. We thank you for your time tonight. We pray that you will continue to study as we go with God, as we seek to do his will, to walk in his word, to work in his word, to worship in his word, because we have to get ready for the warfare. We're in the middle of some dangerous and unprecedented times. But when we walk with God, we on His side. We just praise His wonder, His holy name, because we walk in victory, because we know that all things are going to work together for the good for them that love Him and who are called according to His purpose. We just thank You, we bless You, and we praise His name. Let us get ready for next Wednesday for chapter 2, verse 9 going forward. God, our Father, we thank You for this time of sharing. We thank You for this study tonight as we have dealt with the order of the church. And may we inculcate, may we internalize this teaching tonight. For we know that as the word goes forth, it will not return void, but will accomplish that which You have purposed it to accomplish. And we just thank You. We just bless You. Bless those who are watching us tonight, who have been part of this teaching, that we will be, that word will be hidden in their heart, that we may not sin against Thee. Thank You for this time. We bless You. We magnify Your name. It is the name of Him who is our Christ and soon coming King, we pray. Amen. Go with God.